And that was when Triumph's demographic kind of went, ooh. Because finally girls were coming to the shows and buying tickets. It wasn't just guys with missing teeth and tattoos. I gotta say this for you, sir. Your timing is impeccable. Anyways, it fills up the space between us, and it crosses over the borders and the boundaries of life, and it's the best thing that I have ever found. It's called the magic power.
Ah! like to hear one more song.
There it is, the Rush t-shirt. Yeah. All right, that's great. Sit down, shut up. I don't want to have to go back and, you know, hide. Pretend. Really? Oh, an encore, what a surprise. Yeah, blinding lights, yeah, no, that's not gonna happen. I didn't write that in, I didn't write that with the Sharpie, it's not gonna happen. Dave's gonna do a solo version of Blinding Lights. Yeah, this is the funny thing, eh, about concerts. Like, you get to the end, and you're going to come off your encore, and then for some reason the audience thinks, I have written in Sharpie on the sheet, request hour. And I have not.
We would love that.
I've written one song. One measly little song. Which is what I'm going to do because it's what I rehearsed. And it's all that my 65-year-old brain can retain. Plus, I'm a creature of habit. There's one more thing I want to mention to you folks, because, I mean, it matters nothing, but to me it matters. I had a pretty good night vocally tonight. And, yeah. Thank you. I mean, it's lovely that you agree with me. I wouldn't really give a shit if you did or not. No, that's nice. I'm glad that you agree. But I, you know, for me, I had a good night. And one of the big reasons, and this is, you know, how weird our music career is. Here at the City Winery in Nashville, they have a really nice green room, but it has an even cooler bathroom with a high ceiling that's got one of those big walk-in shower kind of things with the glass. And when you go into that room, it's like it's got the reverb of a church. So I warmed up in the bathroom backstage, and I was just getting off on the sound of my own voice. Because there's this thing that happens, and Dave and I were talking about this, when you generate a note, but the note kind of comes back through your ears and into your body, like there's this thing that happens that raises your game. It's like when you play for an audience, and you know, you're playing and you're into it, but you know that the audience is into it too and they're with you, and so this thing starts to happen. And here come the goosebumps again. Like, it's an unbelievable thing. That's like, I can't explain it, you know? But you know the way the sports teams will say, like, oh, you know, the crowd is really into it. Like, oh, we had the 12th man tonight, you know? Like, it's true. It's like it raises the game. So, anyways, I just wanted you to know that you know, I had a good night because there's a great toilet here. Plus, I love when I can come up with a new little story that Dave's never heard. I can get a smile. All right,
one more show.
Hang on, sorry, I didn't catch it. What did you say, sir?
Bathrooms are important when you're 65.
It is, you're damn straight. Especially with my prostate. My friend Ian Thomas. You know, I don't know if he had hits here. Ian had hits in Canada, and he wrote a song. Yeah, Painted Ladies, and he wrote a song for Santana too. Hold On. Do you remember? Hold on, nothing's the same. Tell me why I feel this way. No, not that whole line.
That's a good one too, though.
Anyways, Ian used to say, yeah, my prostate is the size of the Hindenburg. He'd say it like to his crowd. He'd say in front of his eyes. And now I've said it to you. All right, so here's a tune. I'm going to give my pick to you. There you go. I don't need it. Aww. I need 327 picks.
Yes.
It's not happening. Stop. Buy a Rick Emmett and Dave Dunlop bottle of wine. Yes. Good. Take that home with you. Save it for your 50th anniversary. Okay, here's a tune that's a musician wrote song and a fitting kind of thing to end a show and maybe even a career. So, anyways, this is a song. Look, I love music like nothing else, but you know, I've done a lot of hotels and airports and petitions for visas and all of that kind of shit. And the truth of the matter is, you know, like, my whole life has been all about trying to be ready to play the show. Ooh, but I can't have that second glass of wine. No, 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 I got a gig tomorrow. You know, oh, no, I can't do that, you know. And, oh, I better go to the therapist for my back because I got to get ready for the gigs, you know. Oh, I'm getting arthritis in my fingers. What drug can I take that will make it so that my fingers won't hurt when I play those songs? Like, my life has been all about trying to bring this to you. And my wife would say, it's not a big deal. I was happy to do it. You know, it was a joy for me. But my wife would say, how about some time for us now? I would go, yeah, damn straight. Okay. So that's what's going on. So anyhow, this is, I had a Joe Pass guitar book. I started writing based on some of his chord changes, and then started to extrapolate and make some of my own and add some sections, and then started writing some lyrics. And this is what it was like when I was about, I don't know, 27 or 28 years old on the road, feeling, you know, probably a Holiday Inn with the bottle of Johnny Walker Scotch that came off the rider.
Yeah.
As my companion as I was sitting there at 4 o'clock in the morning. This is called Suitcase Blues. Thank you. Dunlop.